Lives event last year in October. The Oxford Centre, however, opened a little bit later in 2002 in response to a request to employ specifically Tom Downing, who we're happy to have in our audience today because of his experience on the human dimensions of climate change. He was invited to lead a cross-centre programme on risks, vulnerability and livelihoods. In 2002, climate change work was focused very much in a linear model, a stepped approach with meteorologists running global climate models, downscaling outputs, which fed into impact models, and then we would try and think of various adaptation options. A lot of this still goes on today, but we have moved forward. Advances in computing power and the development of information technology. The picture is now very different, with many scientific disciplines having expanded along with the climate problem. Oxford was early to diverge from this linear model and push the agenda on how people, their livelihoods and communities are impacted by climate change, how many other stresses are involved in understanding the effects, and how we make decisions on what should be done about it. SEI Oxford is very different now. It's one of seven SEI centres internationally. Our work has broadened to include adaptation decision-making and translation of climate knowledge for a wide range of users, from a smallholder farmer in Cameroon, for example, up to national governments and global NGOs. Our expertise here is very much on the social and human impact of environmental change. We continue to look at sophisticated methods to tailor climate data for users to support decision-making, learning across the disciplines of disaster risk and climate change adaptation, communicating and sharing information, now known as climate knowledge brokering for adaptation and mitigation, capacity building, of course, and financing actions for adaptation and mitigation, climate negotiations and energy policy and markets. In contrast to the usual summer silly season this year, the media has been full of heartbreaking stories, the migration of Syrians, Afghans, Eritreans and others within their own regions and very much across Europe. The other ongoing story is the climate, of course, with 2015 expected to be the hottest year on record, and we're also heading for the most, it's thought we're heading for the most severe El Nino since 1950. There's ongoing extreme events with the droughts in California leading to wildfires and also flooding in Japan. These stories touch all of us, particularly those working on the environment and development. We're all involved in this climate story now. The Vatican produced a well-received encyclical insisting we embrace the moral aspects of climate change. And the Pope has continued to push his agenda in the US, saying that whatever we do to the environment impacts humanity as well. An Islamic declaration on climate change is also being drafted following an Islamic climate change symposium that was held this August. Other international events also make 2015 a game-changing year in terms of the climate. The adoption of the Sustainable Development Goals just last Friday, the Sende Framework on Disaster Risk Reduction, endorsed by the UN General Assembly, and the upcoming new global deal on climate change expected from COP21 in Paris in November. It could be argued that unstable political and conflict situations in many countries is amplified by uncertainty in the climate. Climate change risk may already be playing a destabilising role in many countries in the Middle East and North Africa by straining water and food resources. While we shouldn't overstate the role of climate change in complex human events, it's also unhelpful to underestimate the complex scale of climate risks. This is the reason why we need, as a global community of academics, practitioners and policy and decision makers, to address climate change through improved learning and exchange of knowledge on climate issues. We need to interpret the climate data, the current climate, future scenarios and economic scenarios, understand the multiple drivers, as I've mentioned, and advance learning to make decisions on financing, adaptation and mitigation actions in the face of an increasingly uncertain climate. through new global initiatives focusing on climate services led by the World Meteorological Office and the European Commission, the European Roadmap for Climate Services and Climate Knowledge, with the Climate Knowledge Brokers Manifesto launched 2 weeks ago. We aim to contribute to these aims. Today we have an expert panel of speakers to address the challenges of communicating climate knowledge to make the best decisions, particularly on behalf of those living in poverty, in marginal areas and suffering the worst consequences of climate change. Sam Bickersteth, our keynote speaker, will discuss the role of SDGs and their links to climate and CDKN's role in climate knowledge brokering. SCI Oxford researchers Sukaina Barwani and Harrow van Asselt will follow with a presentation on putting climate knowledge into practice. We'll have a quick coffee break after that, and then a panel discussion which will be moderated by Kate Lonsdale. Just stand up, Kate, so you can see. She's an SCI associate, and we'll have a wrap-up and closing comments from Yuan and board member Andreas Colgrave. And we hope to conclude the seminar at 12:30, though we are running a little bit late. So I'd like to introduce Sam Bickersteth now. Sam is Chief Executive Officer at CDKN. He's responsible for leading strategy and delivery. He brings a wealth of knowledge in international development, natural resources and climate change, having worked for DFID and Oxfam over many years. As head of program policy at Oxfam, he led DFID programs in Mozambique, Bolivia and Nepal. He's worked and lived in four continents. Most recently, he's led international donor efforts to mainstream agriculture into climate policy negotiations. He also reminded me that he's also a visiting research associate at the Environmental Change Institute here in the University of Oxford. So I'd like to give the stage to Sam. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. This is a great honour to be here with the board. So thank you so much for the invitation from all of you. This is very much an expert gathering. So I think you're the experts. I'm just here to put a few issues on the table to stimulate a conversation. It's very nice to find some friends here from previous incarnations of my work in Oxfam and our ongoing partnerships across CDKN. So thank you very much for the opportunity to share a few thoughts with you this morning. The last few days has been a kind of exciting few days if you're spending your time in the media following climate and SDGs. It's been striking how much climate has been referenced in the statements made in New York through the SDG conversations. And I think there is a real sense that 2015 could be an inflection point about pulling climate change from over there into the heart of the development agenda. And I think I want to share my few thoughts on that in the SDGs with you today. CDKN was set up always to be a development network funded by overseas development assistance by the UK and the Dutch governments. But a lot of the work climate world has occasionally wandered off from that. I think we're bringing climate firmly back into the poverty reduction, growth and development agendas. I was going to share you a few thoughts on knowledge management. I think we'll have a panel that will probably do that much better with you. And I'll probably bring you back to today or even yesterday, which is the INDCs. Very exciting. Gambia and Peru and about five other countries submitted their intended national firm contributions to the UNFCCC yesterday. There's lots happening, and some of it's really good. Ruth's reminded us of the enormous challenges we face. But there's some exciting things underway. So I kind of looked at the title of this event and then I read our mission statement. I realised they were just basically the same. So I thought maybe I'd come to the right event, so that was handy. But over 5 years, CDKN's been going for 4.5 years, we've been using a kind of market approach funded by the UK government, that's what you'd expect, to match best expertise to the needs of developing countries. That huge hole that was so evident at the time of Copenhagen, where developing countries simply didn't have the capacity. We've moved on a huge amount. Many of you have been part of that process before, during, hopefully after the existence of CDKN. We won't exist forever. I mean, this has been a process, but in 5 years that I've been leading CDKN, the capability of countries just to produce their INDCs. Bangladesh produced its INDC. It said, we're going to reduce our own emissions by 5%, with or without international support, 15% conditional. Gambia, 45% submitted yesterday. Some of that's unconditional. That's their work. They've led it. We've supported it. You've supported it, these processes. And what we've done is bring the best expertise from the south, from the north, from around the world to meet the needs of developing countries to fill these huge gaps in knowledge and advice and capability around integrating climate into development challenges. It's worth thinking a little bit about where we got to on the challenge around climate-compatible development. We haven't focused on only on adaptation or focused only on low-carbon development in CDKN. We've deliberately avoided those terms which have been silos in which we've sometimes got imprisoned in the UNFCCC itself. We sought to define CCD as development that minimises harm caused by climate impacts and maximising opportunities. That maximising opportunities, the UK government and particular ministers have gone completely crazy on off-grid renewables at the moment. That's great, that's one of those opportunities, and I'm hoping the African Development Bank president spoke about it yesterday in New York too. So I'm hoping these opportunities will be really seen to be transformative for development reasons, for the 80% of Africans, for example, who don't have access to clean, modern energy systems. So CCD has worked as a general, generic lens for the work that we've done, we would argue. Articulating it in great detail perhaps has worked less well, but I think it's worked well in general. And whether you're coming from Sendai and DRM, or whether you're coming from, if you're an INDC groupie, or whether you're coming from SDGs, it's a really useful framework to look at things. So it was suggested I might remind you of the challenge, but you don't need reminding. I think every one of you knows the challenges around climate change, but I do want to link this back into health and food and water and ecosystems. Very strongly, which the IPCC's fifth assessment did very powerfully last year. We have these opportunities ongoing around the SDGs, and we have the Paris COP as a moment to drive this forward, not a moment that's going to die when we go home on the 9th of December, but that drives through into a change agenda in the period of the SDG implementation to 2030. But it's pretty gloomy, really, when you ask Climate Action Tracker or the UNEP Emissions Gap Report to add up the numbers. It's not looking very good. And the INDCs are, in fact, more or less just articulating the emissions gap that already exists. This was the last year's report. But if you look at the Climate Action Tracker's latest summary, and it excludes Brazil that came in yesterday, which is significant, 65-70% of global emissions, still a large gap of 14 to 17 gigatons for 2030. And so largely the INDCs have just, being bottom-up, have not driven high ambition, they've driven the status that countries have already committed to. Maybe locking that in a little bit more strongly. So that's the positive side of these things. But there's the narratives change around decarbonisation. I don't know whether you were alongside the 0-0 discussions that have happened over the last 18 months. That shift, Target Zero, the NGO advocacy group has advocated this strongly. But to shift the dialogue on net zero by the end, middle to the end of the century, from there to now, is extraordinary. It's directly referenced in the Brazilian INDC published yesterday. So decarbonisation by the end of the century is much more the nature of the dialogue. So you can look at the glass half full, you can look at it half empty. The transformation, I would say, is on its way. But there's some really sticky issues because we don't know whether the ratchet mechanism will get us to the top of this graph. We don't know whether compliance is going to be remotely effective. Is it going to be legally binding? Most people think not, though many would like it to be. Will carbon pricing kick in? And you know, the big one is climate finance going to be sufficient to drive us forward? The UK government's been doing its bit on that. But I think the narrative around this is changing, and we're not, you know, CBKN and SEI in a core in Oxford or London or somewhere else. We're actually part of the mainstream development debate now. That's, I think, where we wanted to be for a while. You guys know very well about climate impacts, and I don't need to remind you. But I think many countries haven't got it. We work with some of you, Paul, here in Nepal, to try and bring better evidence and data to national level rather than a sort of aggregate level IPCC kind of analysis on the impacts of terrestrial on fresh water, on terrestrial ecosystems, and marine ecosystems come down strongly. But all that uncertainty in East Africa, you know, we're working with the Future Climate for Africa program, which is one of those programs that's trying to bring this, the science, the modelling, and the knowledge to a more local basis. But it's still quite generic. There are countries that get it. There are countries who are going to have ambitious INDCs, or have ambitious INDCs, like the Gambia, we can say, as of today, and Peru, and others who have thought about it, struggled with it, Chile, and come up with a disappointing INDC, and others who just aren't engaging at all. So there's still a long journey ahead. The challenge is absolutely massive. And the IPCC has done a very important job to reach out to some, but that former chair said to me, we need to carpet bomb the world with the results of the IPCC. We just want to go out to country after country to share the results, to stimulate a national level debate. And that's happened in some places, but not yet everywhere. So if you're not already familiar with the SDG sort of colour scheme, then I just want to remind you, I just noticed this morning the Prime Minister was in New York with sort of kids holding banner, you know, it's a square each with Justin Greening. But I just want to emphasise the fact that they don't, climate is woven through it, and this is a huge, huge triumph for the Open Working Group, actually, that they delivered these SDGs without climate change just being siloed in the climate action SDG, which itself is weak, many of you know, because it basically deferred decisions to Paris. Many of these, the targets within the goals that I've highlighted here, and you may have spotted others, reference climate change. Even the no poverty one is reduced exposure report of climate-related extreme events. The zero hunger has strengthened capacity for adaptation. The decent work and growth has decoupled economic growth from environmental degradation. It's woven through. Really important point that I want to emphasise. Of course, you can look at those that are related. You know, health, incredibly important. Gender equality. We know about the differential impacts of climate change on men and women, and the different mitigation options that women have. The opportunity for deliberately targeting microfinance, access to resources to women to drive access to renewables and other mitigation opportunities. This is the place where the climate change agenda will be driven from. It won't be driven from SDG 13. It won't be driven from Paris. It will be driven from Parisians realising last Sunday they can enjoy their streets without cars driving around them, or the citizens of Beijing forcing the government to shift its energy policy. So, you know, SDG 3 is really important to SDG 13. This is obvious stuff. You know this stuff. But it's an exciting moment. of climate change sitting in the midst of this, not separately from the midst of the development challenge. The indivisibility, the universality of the intended goals comes out too. So here's a little aside from PwC, which many of you know is where I'm based. They just done a survey on business views on SDGs, and there was quite a lot of business conversation in New York these last few days about SDGs as well. 1,000 businesses were interviewed for this, and they identified a quite high awareness of SDGs amongst the executives across those businesses. But they identified decent work and economic growth as the driver for them, the SDG in particular, which they identified with. Citizens, this is at the bottom here, the bottom line, prioritised hunger, as you would expect, kind of sense of human indignity, of food insecurity, and expect businesses to embed SDGs into their strategies, but the businesses themselves, very few of them are really building this into their strategies. So quite an interesting bit of initial analysis about business engagement. Enlightened self-interest, of course, this is, that's why businesses would get involved in SDGs and thinking about them. And another survey, this is the CEO Pulse survey, this is a different bit of sort of data collection by the PwC network, reminds us that Paris is a milestone, but public awareness, better knowledge and information, 75% of CEOs think will drive action, and clearer national policy framework. It's so important when we're encouraged to think about private channels for action on climate change or private channels for action on development, that we recognise that that actually means the policy environment and the regulatory environment is actually directly working with various private sector actors. So I thought that second column, 75% CEOs think that better information will impact their business. They actually are hungry. They want tools to engage in SDGs. They want tools to think about climate impacts in their business. There's a higher and higher awareness. And I think that's interesting. You know, Paris is comes out less, much less significant. It's just a moment. Very briefly, on some research we funded in partnership with H.R. Wallingford on the relationship between SDGs and the deal in Paris. There's a paper on this which you can find on our website. There's a modelling effort to look at of climate and social economic indicators done globally and picking up a few countries. Essentially, looking at two hypothetical scenarios, a low ambition and a high ambition agreement in Paris, we can see how a low ambition agreement will result in higher poverty levels in Asia and Africa in particular, 80 to 140%. But real numbers in the difference of number of people that come out of poverty, this attempt to summarise what this means. You've got 15 million people under $1.25 a day in Uganda at present, and a scenario with a high ambition outcome in Paris results in a drop of 3 million, and that doesn't get rid of poverty in Uganda, which some models suggest in other countries. But a low ambition drives increased number of people in poverty. And I think it's fairly obvious, but it's worth reminding that there's no point having the SDGs if we don't have a good outcome on climate action. And this is modelled more widely in the paper and with analysis across all 17 SDGs. I won't dwell on this, but as you can see, there's a strong relationship between the levels of ambition from COP21 and the ability to deliver the SDGs in 2030. You can see in particular how that stands out in terms of failure to achieve, high risk of failure to achieve the SDGs in gender equality or poverty or inequality. According to this analysis, it's preliminary analysis, but it's an interesting model of looking at that relationship, and encourage you to have a look at it. And kind of related to that, there's a sort of set of, I mean, just going to conclude this part of my conversation really here, that COP21 isn't just about emissions reductions. We know that's why many countries have wanted adaptation to be very much part of the process. But high ambition will drive more international cooperation. You can see the shift in the UK aid programme into climate action over the announcement of the Prime Minister over the last couple of days. But it also drives in private finance as well. You know, a renewables revolution in Africa, that's the ambition of the president of the African Development Bank, will drive other innovations itself. It will come on to the back of the telecom revolution, but it will drive a broader thing. So it's broader development processes. A low ambition, the opposite, is more likely to see increased inequality, possible new forms of trade restrictions emerging, and the kind of things that we've seen haven't been facilitating international development. So just a few remarks on knowledge management and networks. I was asked to talk a bit about this. I mean, you've all been, I think nearly all of you, part of this process and know a great deal about this. But I think in CDKN we've had some success, essentially because we were given the flexibility by DFID and a mandate to integrate knowledge management into everything that we've done. We've had an adequate budget to do it well. We've integrated this into our projects and programs. We've been very demand-led to listen to what, as it were, our developing country clients want and appreciate, and the network. It's sometimes through intermediaries, there's a knowledge, climate knowledge brokers that we've supported, has been. But the broad range of tools is the first thing, I would say. Demand-led. It's building on what's there. We haven't sought to create new things often. We've tried to build on existing networks, and we've listened and adapted. And just for the next few slides, talk about some of the ways we've used this. We've had a whole series of papers called Inside Stories, and I'm pleased to note that one of those listed here was a collaboration with SEI Summonet. So Eric and I were just talking about this one, but we agreed there's actually a better example in Chiang Mai. But really exciting processes of data analysis with communities, with leadership leading to action in Hue and then in Chiang Mai, which really led to a clean central zone in that city. Some amazing process in Cartagena where there was some analysis of the impacts of sea level rise. Tom Downing was involved in this some years earlier as well, bringing that into the political process through five changes of mayors in the intervening years, and now really leading to one of the first adaptation plans for a major Latin American city. I could go on. The Ahmedabad heat health thing has been the most striking story of how you can bring data analysis around mortality, good analysis of public health, really good communications, and strong leadership by the municipality of that city that really has saved lives in that city in India in the heat wave last May. So telling the stories, they matter. It's not just about writing research papers, telling the stories and reaching out, communicating them. And yeah, we want to bring people in through a whole variety of means of communications, pull people in a way that they're comfortable, whether it's videos or guides or papers, and making them well organized and accessible. And we want to push stuff out. We want to reach out through other networks. We work with the Eldest Network. We work with other networks, the Low Emission Development Strategies Network, which we're now co-delivering, funded by the US government. The Climate Knowledge Brokers is an example of collaboration as well. And we're working with university networks, in particular in Southern Africa, to reach out. Of course, meetings like this, it can't be substituted. Once in a while, we do need to get together, and building those communities of practice require us to see each other once in a while. A couple of people that haven't met in this room for 4 or 5 years at similar meetings, but you know, once in a while, we do need to engage, and that drives the sharing. The power of hearing a story across the table directly can never be undermined, and I've seen that in the LEDS Global Partnership with Southern practitioners talking to one another and really spreading the possibilities of low carbon development and their own stories of driving that through their governments. The Knowledge Brokers Network is great. We've been very happy to support that process. It's kind of in the background, it's there, it's enabling better access. There's some technology behind it, there's widgets that share, that enable to tag across related websites, and setting out the principles of working together. Several of you have been part of the launch that was just last week. So I thought I'd just close with telling you about the process in Peru, which has been an interesting process of co-creation by a number of actors over the last 2.5 years, which has led directly to the government of Peru submitting its INDC just yesterday. Plan CC is the National Mitigation Plan, by and large, although adaptation comes into the INDC, this is a mitigation plan of Peru. And rather than going to Copenhagen with a you know, proverbial back of the fag packet calculation on emissions reductions of what they did in 2009, objective, robust data for decision making, drawing on the best capabilities of national institutions and the data, and building consensus at the same time, not sort of doing the analysis and then doing the consensus, but an integrated approach. This was a large exercise, it was expensive, it was funded by the Peruvian government, ourselves, and the Swiss government and the Children's Investment Fund, Foundation CIF, and brought a lot of actors together, communications experts very much part of the team, and a carefully constructed governance process and political process at high level to guide it, and it brought in the private sector. Amazing stories about the cement industry going to the first meetings, basically to kind of block it, and then realizing there was an opportunity, and then engaging, and then looking at clean cement technologies as a consequence of that. And this is not a very clear slide just to set out the complexity of this process, really. A research team, scenarios building team, and technical consulting groups. Lots of different groups working together, well facilitated by our partner in Peru, Libelula, who I should mention here, and came up with a number of scenarios. The scenarios were still just scenarios on paper, 73 mitigation options they came up with. And that's great, but nothing's changed in Peru, really, as a consequence of that. I think they're talking about changing the light bulbs in the city of Lima, which was one of them. But, you know, actually, you're still on paper here. You've involved a lot of citizens. But you've engaged with the impacts on productivity. Minister Pulgar Vidal, you know, he's had a tough time from energy and industry ministers over the last year during the COP presidency, as I'm sure you will know. Part of it has been this debate about the future opportunities for low carbon growth or future directions of growth in a very fast growing economy. The engagement of the Ministry of Economy and Finance was absolutely critical, as I think you all know. We spend too much time talking to our friends in the Ministry of the Environment, and that's often the wrong place to be. But there we are. They came up with four scenarios in their draft INDC 3 months ago, which ranged, I think, from 4% to 42%, and they've come up with the mid to upper one of the 30% emissions reductions target, which is, just looking at that, this is 10% unconditional, or 20% unconditional. So they're going to do a 20% reduction themselves, with or without international cooperation, and a further 10% given international support. So this critical mix, whether it's the story from Hue, it's a story from Chiang Mai, a city level, a story at national level, this critical mixture of analysis, stakeholder engagement, political leadership and communications, that resonates through, and I'm sure that will resonate in the work that many of you are also doing. So I'm going to stop really about here, just to recap, to share my enthusiasm for the importance of focusing on the development deficit and climate change being integrated. That you can call it CCD, climate compatible development, you can call it climate mainstreaming, you can call it something else, but it's really critical that we see that integration, this opportunity for integration at this stage. In terms of knowledge management and networks and partnerships, Again, we might give that a number of names. We're calling it knowledge networking. That needs to be well resourced. And sometimes research programs don't do it. They add it on afterwards. Encourage your donors to integrate it fully into the cycle of funding and what you do. You're going to get a much more applied and direct action, get the action that you want. We need to build in learning. How are we going to do that? Sometimes we don't have the resources to do that. That's where our own institutions play in. We have to find our resources and integrate learning as we go. We can find champions at local level to do that with. It's part of the capacity building process very often to have an integrated learning cycle into these programs and projects that we run. And careful construction of the stakeholders, not a casual construction, but careful construction both of who's involved at different levels, and the governance of that is so often important. The process is the thing that bedevils most CBKM projects, not the technical results, and we've learned that. And finally, let's not forget the finance. I mean, we have generous donors, all of us. We rest largely on public funding. I think in the UK, we've been lucky, and the Prime Minister announced a further £5.8 billion worth of climate finance over the next 6 years. That's for developing countries. We should never forget that. But you know, we've underpinned that. The knowledge aspects of that is seen as central and important to it. So, you know, we've had generous supporters, but the needs are absolutely enormous. Finance, this UK government announcement, you will have seen some of the analysis and commentary over whether it's enough or not. It may be about $2 billion a year from the $100 billion promised Copenhagen. So, you know, it's not very much, is it? But we know it's going to come from public and private resources. We know it's going to come from domestic resources. The IMDC has already demonstrated how much developing countries are putting on the table from their own domestic resources. It's a partnership between the international and the domestic resources. It's a partnership between public and private. And that's going to require a shift in the way we work. I was at the launch of the African Development Bank's New Deal for Energy in Abidjan last week. And I will tell you, it was a much less comfortable meeting to be in. I don't know whether you're going to make it uncomfortable from this kind of gathering. You know, this kind of gathering of research policy practitioners is the space where we work together. When you're sitting with bankers and technology entrepreneurs, they want knowledge packaged in a really different way. We've got to communicate differently in different ways to different audiences, and we haven't always done that terribly well. And we tend to find it easier communicating to people that like what we do in our own kind of organisation. So I think the exciting challenge for us, whether it's SER or CDKM or whoever, is finding new ways of making new partnerships and collaborations work and adding value. Knowledge and information, the CEOs told us, matters. They want it, but how are we going to get it to them in the right form? So with that, I'd like to close and thank you again for this opportunity to share some of this.
Thank you very much for that, Sam. For that sort of overview of some of the exciting challenges, but also demonstrating there are stories of successes and stories of change, and even that it's a positive transformation on the way. We are running over time a little bit, but I'm going to allow two questions. For some. Anyone got a burning question? Otherwise we'll move on to the camera. Okay, you are?
So maybe a short question about, I mean, you are working in many different countries, obviously, and you have supported a lot of interesting processes together with a lot of partners. And in the end here, you mentioned, you know, the need to package information maybe in different ways, in order to attract also key groups that may not see themselves as part of this agenda. How do you deal with that in practice? Can you give an example, maybe from a country where you have actually managed to, well, you mentioned Peru a little bit, but you have managed to mobilize key actors for change by repackaging information or sort of putting in place a different kind of process than what you would initially have intended to do.
I mean, the first thing is you can't do it from London, Oxford, or Stockholm. So the first thing is you need to be packaging it with local eyes and knowledge and capability. So until we built our capability in our focus countries, CDKM, as you may know, really spread itself very thinly in its first couple of years. We went to the market and lots of good ideas came up, including from SEI. But we ended up with lack of focus. So focusing on 12 countries plus the Caribbean sub-region, which itself is a challenge I was talking about just now, to somebody else, has worked much better. So having that capability and those relationships, and then you're there to start understanding the new ones. You can't just take a model from Oxford or the UK and dump it in Peru or the Gambia. It's a long, careful construction. And then having skilled facilitators. I mean, the value of the facilitator that can work across boundaries and communicate across boundaries is critical and structured from there. And those are two ingredients. I'm sure there are many more. And those two work well in the Peru context. Soft things, I'm sure they're not giving you hard bit. It's that soft stuff that really matters.
Thanks, Sam. Most of the information, knowledge, data that is available to us who are working with the communities, with the farmers, I would say, that is, the information is either global or at the best at the national level. When we go to the farmers to talk to them on climate change, we seldom get the information that they need at their level. One is because still the information is at the macro level. Second, the climate change is having a varying impact on the farmers, on the different crops. They are struggling to switch from one crop to the other, from one technology to the other, and they are that's making their livelihoods more vulnerable and risky. And then they are working on the adaptation plans and processes, having always less information than before to adapt to the changing situation. So how these knowledge networks can translate the existing information to more like local situations. The most of the climate change models produce information that is forecasting at the national level. So I talk to different researchers and institutions, and when we say I'm going to such and such region, what information I can take there? The answer is no, we don't have that information.
Shahid, I don't think I have a straightforward answer to your question. Yes, of course, climate models, you know, best the resolution might be 50 square kilometres, and that's not very helpful for a farmer in a particular location. Government can set policy, that government can provide subsidies or get rid of unhelpful subsidies. It can facilitate access to knowledge and build the local institutions. I think in climate smart agriculture, there's a lot of action in that, and we're working with CCAS in Nepal around testing some of these ideas. It has to be rooted in local, and it may not be called climate change as well. We need to adapt to what we're talking about and communicating about. But at livelihood level, the challenge is you're entering through the other SDGs, aren't you? And then you integrate that background noise that climate change is taking, and disaster risk management, as you know very well in the Asian, in Pakistan in particular, is the big driver for action there, and to shift from, you know, 1 in 10 year big flood to 1 in 2 year flood, you're completely having to adapt. That's about those contacts in the ground. But national level, it's about having planning mechanisms and relief mechanisms to back that up. So I think the multiple tiers is difficult. It's really challenging. I hear what you're saying. But I think we're seeing the connectivity in knowledge, potentially more.
Okay, thank you very much. I think Sam's going to be around the whole morning, so if you've got other responses to his talk, you can do it in the coffee break, maybe. At this point, I'm going to introduce our graphic recorder, Chris, Chris Shipton, who is capturing the main points that are coming up in words and in images. And Chris says he's very happy for people to come and talk to him if they feel like something else should be added, or some comment or other ideas for metaphors to use, images. And the idea is that this will provide both a record of today and also something for us to engage with and think about and sort of provoke thoughts for the discussion. Thank you. Okay, so at this point we've got two of our Oxford SEI's senior researchers, Harrow van Asselt and Tukena Bahwani, and they're going to talk about their putting climate knowledge into practice in their experience. So Harrow joined SEI in 2012 and the Oxford office in 2014, and works mostly on international and EU climate law and policy. And Tukena joined when SEI Oxford started in 2002 and is now co-lead of the transforming governance theme in SEI. And she's got a very interesting background in both computing and social anthropology, which gives her a particularly unique perspective on how you create sort of usable climate information for decision making.
Right. Thank you, Kate, and thank you, Ruth, for this morning, and thanks, Sam, for a really, really interesting keynote presentation just now. And thanks, of course, also to all of you for coming here this morning, both here in person and online. This is a bit new for me, because this is on the first time that I'm doing a duo presentation, and also the first time that I'm doing a Prezi presentation. I'm actually quite excited about both, but I think I'm sure it will work well. So we're trying to address the main theme that brought us together here this morning. So how can we put climate knowledge into action? And what Sukane and I want to do in this presentation is we want to offer you some perspectives from SEI Oxford collectively on how to move from climate knowledge to climate action. So I will go through this part relatively quickly because both Ruth and Sam already addressed it in their presentations this morning. But 2015 is a very crucial year, and as Sam was saying, a very exciting year as well, especially if you're doing research in these areas, for looking at global processes in the area of climate change and sustainable development. So as both of you mentioned already, just this Friday, 17 sustainable development goals were adopted in New York, and also later this year, the expectation is that in Paris, or the hope is that in Paris, a new and ambitious climate change agreement will be adopted at COP21. So seemingly everyone is getting involved in the sustainability agenda. And you saw that in New York as well, where we not only have the Pope getting involved, but also Shakira, seeing right after the Pope. But at the same time, if you move away a little bit from the glitz and the glamour, from the international agreements and the international processes, it sometimes gets a bit difficult to actually see how these processes can make an impact on the ground. And it's important to keep in mind the social change that we're trying to bring about. We definitely need to link the global to the local and the quantitative indicators that are being developed internationally to local and real-world situations. Partly in recognition of these issues, what happened recently in 2014 is that UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon established a global expert advisory group on a data revolution for sustainable development. And this group called for the development of a global consensus on data principles and standards, on the sharing of knowledge for the common good, on new resources for capacity development and greater data coordination. And in addition, we believe that new research methods and technologies are starting to actually help us explore some of the previously inaccessible and unusable data and information. This is important as it will help us to learn transferable lessons on climate change issues from the massive data that is being produced on a daily basis. There's a but. However, as the American biologist E.O. Wilson once said, is that we're drowning in information while we're actually starving for wisdom. And this is one of the risks that we're very much facing in this community as well. more data doesn't necessarily equal better data. Instead, what we're facing is the risk of an overload of unstructured information, which can be confusing for those seeking to bring about change, as well as the users. And there's a risk that we start actually to ask the wrong questions with all the data that is becoming available, because we can pretty much ask any question we want. This means that the research methods that can help us ask the right questions become absolutely critical. So what we're doing now is based on our collective experiences and our shared history, we've identified several broad principles for climate adaptation and mitigation research. And these principles, we believe, can help us keep in mind the impact that we're trying to achieve when designing our research and our engagement. And conveniently, and also importantly, when it comes to communication, all start with the C. In the next few minutes, Cicada and I will briefly explain these principles and how they could help us overcome the challenges and putting climate knowledge into practice. And clearly, these are not the only principles that are matter, because I think already Simon's presentation this morning highlighted some important things that we need to keep in mind, and I'm quite sure that the expert panel later on will make other points as well. And let us start with the first one, about the context. First of all, it's important to understand the context in which we are working, and we do not always fully appreciate that. Understanding the context means that it's understanding that climate change is only one of many stressors in a particular context. It's understanding that climate change may be one of the various risks perceived, and that climate change in the end is only one of a range of factors that matter for decision making. So effective decision making support needs to be sensitive to this context, and needs to be sensitive to the different stakeholder needs, the diversity of knowledge types, and the decision making processes at play. For example, we know that a deeper understanding of local context can help us to develop better adaptation strategies. And this is one of the things that we did in one of our projects, in this case, EcoAdapt in Latin America, where Tahir and Monica, who are sitting here as well, have applied a social network analysis. And this method has helped them to understand better the actor networks in Latin American countries in which they worked, to understand formal and informal relationships, to understand the flows of information and resources between the different actors, to look at existing power relations and assess them critically, as well as the norms and values shaping the decisions and made on climate change adaptation. And this has helped them to identify entry points for designing and implementing effective adaptation strategies for water management, for aligning worldviews of different actors, including private sector, public bodies, grassroots organizations, and so on. And in another project, something similar. And here, it is a project called COBAM, and again, Monica and Tahir have been very heavily involved, as well as Sukena. And this is a project that took place in the Congo Basin. And here, several integrated vulnerability assessments were carried out to develop a deeper understanding of the social, political, and cultural context. And this has helped them to understand the multiple stresses that people were responding to, which were not limited to climate change impacts only. It also offered insights into the coping mechanisms that could help plan future strategies that provide benefits for both forests and livelihoods. So moving on now to the second principle, which is about connecting. One of the things is that we need to understand is that we need to better connect both with user needs, but also connect information with each other. Different users in different countries operating at different levels inevitably have different user needs. And for online information portals where users from all over the world are brought together, this is actually particularly important. And what you see increasingly is with one of the ongoing features of the data revolution, which I just referred to, is that we are witnessing an emergence of an increasing number of web-based portals containing a lot of information on climate change impacts, on climate change adaptation options, on mitigation options and policies, and so on. And some have referred to this as the portal proliferation syndrome. So if you look at, for example, the adaptation platforms, this is just a rough selection, but certainly by no means exhaustive. We have quite a few portals that focus on impacts and adaptation options and practices. Similarly, what has emerged, especially in the last 2 years, is we have a number of platforms that focus on non-state climate action and try to capture what the actions is that are being taken by businesses, by NGOs, and by subnational authorities. And at the same time, we're also seeing an increasing amount of information on mitigation policies. And this is particularly important given that the focus is increasingly not at what happens at the international level, but at the national level, as Sam was already referring to, given that the contributions at the international level are now nationally determined. So knowing what happens at the national level is increasingly important. So what we see is that we have an increasing amount of information, but how can we move from useful information, information that we can access, to actually usable information? And in that sense, I think one of the principles that we're trying to convey here is that it's actually important to connect to the users that you're engaging with, to really understand what it is these users are looking for. And again, a good example here is from our own experience, in this case with the WeAdapt platform. And Oxford's WeAdapt platform engages with users in sharing information, as shown on the slide here. They run training sessions with users and explore how users engage with adaptation and climate-related information on other portals. So what you can see is that at least by trying to directly engage with the user community, adaptation portals can already benefit from that. But similarly, the same could be said for some of the mitigation-related portals and the platforms on non-state climate action, where user engagement is not yet at the same level. Connections could also be improved among the different platforms themselves. And again, the impacts and adaptation platforms offer quite a good example here. So what you see here is, on the one hand, the climate information portal, which presents useful information about, let's say, basic climate data, so precipitation, rainfall, etc. At the same time, we have the WeAdapt platform, which provides useful information about adaptation practices and options in different locations. So what has happened, and this is facilitated by the Climate Knowledge Brokers Network, is that WeAdapt, the climate information portal, and AfricaAdapt, the third platform, started to collaborate to share climate-related information, to offer tailored adaptation guidance, and to implement on-the-ground activities, all making use of the respective strengths of each platform. So what you can see now is that this development is actually taking place also in other areas. So what you have now under the UNFCCC, which was launched last year by the Peruvian government together with the Climate Change Secretariat, you have the NASCA platform, where they collect information from several sources, including the Carbon Disclosure Project and the Carbon N Registry, to basically list and map the commitments and actions taken by a range of non-state actors. So again, combining information to come up with a more powerful message, but also to basically provide more usable data. And similarly, and I don't show this on the slide, but similarly, the International Energy Agency and the International Renewable Energy Agency started to collaborate to bring together information on renewable energy policies. So you see the same developments taking place through different areas related to climate change. So all these efforts can not only, we believe, help reduce confusion amongst users, but they can also result in the end in more usable information. And with that, I would like to hand it over to Sukena.
So clearly, in all of these processes, face-to-face engagement is key. Whether this is through processes undertaken to understand user needs or through training and capacity building. So having talked about online portals and knowledge brokering, we will now move on to another aspect, how we produce knowledge face-to-face. As defined in the Climate Knowledge Brokers Manifesto launched 2 weeks ago, knowledge production is also part of the knowledge brokering role. Generally speaking, we are all knowledge brokers, and we are all part of a chain of both producing knowledge and using knowledge at the same time. In our research, co-producing knowledge has been particularly important to allow all concerned to get on the same page, align jargon, understand differing perceptions and worldviews, and make different interests, priorities, and timescales explicit. This is important, especially when climate is often only one aspect of the complex issues at hand. This balance between co-producing and brokering knowledge, what we are increasingly referring to in our work as co-exploration, requires a process of iterative social and institutional learning. Its key value lies in bringing decision makers and climate scientists together to co-explore needs and co-create new knowledge. At the same time, and perhaps counterintuitively, we also find that sometimes new knowledge has to be needs-informed rather than needs-driven. For example, insights from fundamental climate science need to create demand for its application and use. However, for this new knowledge to become decision-relevant, iterative co-exploration processes between scientists and decision makers are still key. This approach has been piloted to co-explore decision makers' needs in the city context of Mozambique and Accra in 2013, and the ability of knowledge providers to meet these needs. And working with climate scientists at the University of Cape Town, the approach will now be fully tested to work in six cities in Southern Africa, where spaces for co-exploration will be created in city learning labs, with researchers embedded in each city, working at the core of municipal governments to try and understand the needs of decision makers and their priorities over the next 4 years. Of course, better understanding user needs where possible enables communication in a more effective way to our stakeholders. This means climate information not only needs to be credible and decision relevant, as we have heard, but that in this era of information overload, it also needs to be tailored and translated into formats that are accessible and actionable by different groups with differing needs and differing capacities. It also means that different modes of delivery need to be explored to translate science into digestible knowledge products, as well as training and capacity building for applying this knowledge. Good examples for sharing information exist in the use of radio and mobile phones, in addition to the online portals we've mentioned. Indeed, public participation in data collection, such as crowdsourcing and citizen science, are becoming increasingly common. This means that the issues and data are driven by those affected by the challenge at hand, and that outputs are more likely to represent their needs. Having discussed some of the key principles we focus on when designing our research for effective adaptation and some examples of how we do this, I want to go into a little bit more detail about how this has helped us ask better questions, and whether indeed it has helped us to ask better questions. There are innovative approaches that help us to access potential blind spots, the unknown unknowns, which can actually lead to unintended outcomes, such as increased vulnerability or maladaptation. How do the global climate and development goals actually translate into local realities, and what questions should they be encouraging us to ask? All of the methods and approaches mentioned support people to articulate their needs better and help us to ask better, different, or new questions to achieve these common goals. However, they are resource intensive and require time to do well. This is the challenge. These approaches include a combination of qualitative and quantitative methods, ranging from integrated vulnerability assessments, as Hara mentioned, through to interactive games, agent-based models, and big data visualization. They employ a range of disciplines, from ethnographic approaches through to more technical artificial intelligence techniques and social simulation methods. Some insights that these mixed methods have provided are in our research in the Congo Basin. For example, instead of assuming that the solution to forest degradation, low productivity, and agricultural expansion is drought-tolerant crops, we have to instead ask ourselves how farmers can ensure land inheritance for their children, or whether there are alternatives. Inheritance is their primary concern and a key driver of agricultural expansion. That is, it is not only due to low productivity. Therefore, the additional and more pertinent questions we need to focus on are those related to land access, customary land rights, and long-term security. Secondly, in Cameroon, local NGOs are considering whether to pilot the development of local markets for the sale of forest products. These are assumed to be strong safety nets for women and poor households traditionally. However, a combination of ethnographic interviews and interactive games made us realize that not all women in the community rely equally on all forest products. In fact, exactly those higher value forest products being considered for market expansion are the ones that women from the poorest households do not collect. Therefore, without further research into local knowledge about the real drivers of decision making, the creation of such a market mechanism could in fact make the poorest more vulnerable. Finally, to learn lessons from around the world about climate knowledge and climate action, We have applied some data visualization techniques to explore patterns in the growing We Adapt knowledge base, SEI's global platform on climate adaptation. Here, sharing lessons learned in both a bottom-up yet semi-structured way has enabled some analysis about which organizations are working on which topics and in which particular sectors and in which regions. This approach may enable us to carry out some systemized comparative analysis and facilitate learning about what works and what doesn't. This image, for example, tells us an interesting story about active members on WeAdapt who are sharing many lessons learned, the bigger nodes, and who are working on similar issues, those closer together. Removing SEI and its partners from this network would allow other active members to become visible, not only identifying gaps, but also commonalities, and thus windows of opportunity for collaboration. Further analysis in this way could help to avoid replication, redundancy, and reinventing the wheel in our projects. And as mentioned by Sam, the importance of SummerNet as a network of SEI is something that was clear from these visualizations that we did. And you can see that if you want to access some of the publications on the table over there where it's explained in more detail. Big data visualization benefits from the current efforts to move towards more open data standards and more systematization, allowing us to understand this data better, generate new insights, and in the case of WeAdapt, transferable lessons. This also allows us to create highly visual messages from the mass of information out there and communicate them in impactful ways. We have not been able to go into a lot of detail here, but we hope that this presentation has offered a little insight into the long history of innovative research at SEI Oxford. The extent to which we explore the real questions in each of the C's we have discussed determines how effective our actions are. We cannot start with the assumption that we have the right questions and therefore the right outcomes in mind. This is especially significant now at a time when we have access to so much data. And this is why innovative and transdisciplinary research methods are increasingly important. A deeper understanding of context, connecting with user needs and learning together through co-exploration, supported by both digital and non-digital research methods, links us to the possibility of transformational insights. This will allow us to reflect upon and critique our current approaches in truly novel ways by exploring the unknown unknowns. This is where transformational learning and the potential for social change really lies. It is also the key when we are thinking about the potential disparity between global goals and local realities and making the link from knowledge to action at all scales. Ultimately, this is critical for measuring our impact. Clearly, this is our common objective at all the scales at which we are working and in all the different areas of our research. Translating global climate and development goals to the local level and co-producing knowledge to identify the right questions to achieve these goals is where we all have a key role to play in the post-2015 agenda. Finally, we hope that this is just the start of a dialogue about how we can accelerate knowledge to action. Common core principles can create positive ripple effects, getting us closer to our common objectives. We would really like to use this morning as an opportunity to learn from the experiences of everyone here in moving from climate knowledge to climate action, and we're really looking forward to a stimulating conversation. So with that, I will hand back to Kate.
Thank you very much, Harar and Sikaina, for very interesting principles for moving from climate knowledge to climate action. And also, that they touch on a vast amount of projects. It gives just some sense of the amount of work that SEI has been doing in this area. I'm very conscious of the time, and I'm also conscious that connecting is a very important thing. So I think we'll keep the coffee break to 20 minutes. And Haro and Sukaina will be available if you want to ask them about specific projects, but also other, would the other SEI researchers, Oxford researchers stand up so that you could also talk to Tahia or Monica, is Monica? yeah, Monica and Annalie, and who else?
Richard,
yes. and if you want to ask about a specific piece of work, and maybe use the coffee break to do that, so that we can move on with the programme. After the break, it's going to get much more interactive. We will have an expert panel, but as both Sam and Sukaina mentioned, there are also many other experts in the room, and we want to hear from you. So after the break, we're going to have a much more interactive discussion, which hopefully will be useful for everybody. Thank you. Okay, welcome back, everybody. So we've got a panel of four people who are going to each offer, introduce themselves, and they say something about why this issue is of interest to them, and then come up with a question for everybody to sort of provoke a conversation. Okay, so I'm going to start with Tahir Devaisha. Would you like to introduce yourself, say something about why this issue is of interest to you, and a provocation for the audience?
I'm a research fellow at the... I'm a research fellow at the Stockholm Environment Institute here in Oxford. Most of my work focuses on social and ecological adaptation in developing countries. And an important aspect of the projects I'm involved in is in supporting adaptation decisions, understanding how climate change will further intensify the stresses and disturbances that are already affecting the systems we're working in. For these projects, and many of them were introduced by my colleagues earlier this morning, climate knowledge brokering has played a key role in helping us contextualize climate data and share expert interpretation and information that also involve local experiences to support in more relevant and useful ways decision making. So in this regard, I think climate knowledge brokering has done a tremendous progress in recent years in improving the ways we share information and the way that different communities of practice can access information and data. Of course, without doubt, this has helped to overcome some epistemological barriers, but I think that to push the boundaries even further and to strengthen the way that knowledge brokering can really facilitate or contribute to climate action, there could be a more meaningful role that knowledge brokering could play in facilitating spaces for different stakeholders to come together and openly deliberate their interests and their views and collectively come to decisions and solutions. This would be a more inclusive way to produce knowledge in a way it would contest the dominant way of knowledge production and contest power dynamics and allow for new framings that can, in a way, be a bit out of the box to look for different ways of addressing climate change and working on effective adaptation. And so this is my provocation, and I think my question for the audience in this regard is how can then knowledge brokering take this a step further and move from information sharing to really a process of co-production or co-exploration, as Kena mentioned today, co-exploration of knowledge to find more systemic and collective actions. And I think some examples were given today, like the city labs, city learning labs, and this project we're going to start. This is really testing an approach. We don't really know what is the modality of how is this really going to happen, how are we going to bring different people together that in cities work very much in silos because different sectors are working on their priorities, but we have to bring them together to share with scientists and to really like co-produce or co-explore solutions. I remember we worked on a project some years ago that was trying to find different ways to communicate climate risk, and we used art for this. We used music and theater and filmmaking to bring different people together, politicians, you know, policymakers, with farmers, to discuss and deliberate topics from their different worldviews. But at some point, the challenge was, this worked very well at the local level, but how can we upscale this to a, you know, more wider level? And I think maybe media, you know, mass media could play a role in this. Technology could also play a role in this, and maybe this is something that the audience can discuss when addressing these questions. Sam earlier this morning said that the private sector and the banks were very interested in accessing better tools, better information, decrease their impact on climate action. How do we package this and how do we improve? What's this modality? How can we interact with them better? And I'm going to be a bit even more critical and self-protective, I think, and say, well, is providing these spaces for deliberation enough? Sam gave an example this morning about how Peru has developed their CC, and he mentioned how complex this process was, how difficult, you know, how much money and time and resources went into bringing different actors together to discuss multiple scenarios and multiple strategies. And well, it seems like they have been successful, they have developed a plan, but this is still paper. And he said there was still no action really being seen. So is this deliberation and space for interaction enough, or how do we really move knowledge, information, knowledge and information sharing to action?
Thank you, Tahir. So just to confirm, your question is, are these spaces enough? Are these deliberative spaces enough?
So how do we move information from information sharing to knowledge co-production to action? And what's, you know,
okay,
who should be involved and how we...
Okay, great. Brilliant. Thank you. Blaine, could you introduce yourself, say where you're interested, and give your publication?
Sure. So I'm Blaine Harvey. I'm a research associate with the Overseas Development Institute, where I'm a part of their adaptation and resilience team. My interest really lies around learning and knowledge, and especially in working with those who are kind of at the last mile of the information chain, if you will, and understanding how they can not only use information, but can contribute to building our understanding of climate impacts and the experience of climate impact. At the same time, I've been working with ODI, with DFID, IDRC, and the CGIAR on understanding how large-scale initiatives, big programs that DFID and others are now investing in, can better support the use of evidence in research for development. This includes the BRACE program, where I'm working, and I'm spending a lot of my time working with the knowledge management hub that's been set up at ODI that focuses on learning and on monitoring and evaluation. My provocation builds a little bit on something that you've just mentioned, Tahi, and also on Sam's stories that he shared of some of the effectiveness. And I want to challenge that if we're really serious about supporting decision making as a community of practice, we need to get a lot better at understanding and measuring success when it comes to knowledge brokering. I think it's critical to planning new actions as we go forward, to learning from what we're doing right now, and to ensuring that these things that have been set up already can be sustained in the future. We have to have compelling cases that actually illustrate how we've gone from knowledge to action and why it's worked. So I would put sort of three challenges to knowledge brokers out there and those who are working in the research for development sphere. And the first is to ask them really, do you have a clearly defined and evidence-informed theory of change that posits how the knowledge you broker will lead to change in action within the communities that you're aiming to support? Interestingly, Duncan Green from Oxfam asked the same of the SDGs this morning in a blog. What's your theory of change? He has a famous diagram that he likes to show where in the middle of it says, and then the magic happens. And really, it's sort of trying to dig out that question of how do we know that we know that simply making information available isn't enough, even if it's good information. And we also know that there's no one-size-fits-all strategy. We've heard that from other presenters today. So really, what is the theory that you understand as brokers that leads people to adopt and to have lasting adoption of solutions, of information, of actions? Secondly, what kind of indicators will show over time, as you go forward, whether you're making progress towards those kinds of changes that you envision? We can collect statistics on who's downloading or accessing our documents, who's turning up at the events that we host, but it tells us a fraction of the story, really. We want to understand, I think, and we need to understand, what do people do with this evidence? Are the changes in action sustained over time? Do they lead to changes in terms of real development on the ground? And do these learning processes, these co-exploration processes really kind of help us to get there? What contribution are those making, as opposed to simply a push model of getting information out of communities? This is some work that John Ensor and I, he's at the SEI office in New York, have been doing, trying to understand, for example, social learning and what it brings. And I think that here we really need to use a range of indicators that are complemented by longitudinal analysis, including ethnographic research. I was glad Kirsten Kinnan mentioned the value of ethnographic research to understand how we can make change lasting and transformative. And the last one that I would raise is whether we're looking beyond individuals. I think often when we're looking at decision-making, we look at decision-making at the scale of the individual. And I think to do that in isolation, we neglect the sort of systemic factors that actually allow people to make decisions within a context. That when we're supporting governance or policy world, we take into account the turnover and the sort of the transformations that happen within institutions. And simply building capacities of individuals does not necessarily take us towards the kinds of lasting changes that we probably need to be seeing. So we need to be thinking about how to track our success at systemic levels and institutional levels much more thoroughly. This is some of the work that the Brace Knowledge Management Hub is trying to ask itself right now. They're tricky questions, but I guess the provocation we put to you is, are we doing enough to understand what success looks like? Do we have the right tools to measure it as we go, not just at the end of our interventions?
Okay, thank you, Blaine. So that final question was the provocation. So can you just repeat that final?
Are we doing enough to track and measure success? Do we have the right tools
yeah.
to make sure we're doing so effectively?
Brilliant. Thank you. Right, I'm now going to hand over to Paul Watkins, who's going to introduce himself, say why this is of interest to him, and make a provocation to the audience.
Okay. Good morning. My name is Paul Watkins, and I'm an associate of Stockholm Environment Institute, Oxford. I interpreted my remit this morning as I get to rant at you for 2 minutes, then I get to ask you a question, and then SEI buys me lunch. So it's effectively my perfect morning. So I'm going to go with that. I think what's really interesting is we live in very interesting times if you work in climate change at the moment. And people have already started talking about some of the shifts and the shocks around 2015. And I just want to add 2 extra ones to that, and then at the end of it, ask you a question. So the first one is, I think 2015 is going to be the year where we really start to experience climate change. We've all talked about the 2015 ENSO, but also this is the bit when the climate models kick up and we get the acceleration. We move from 0.8 degrees of warming over a century to 1.5 times that amount in the next 30 years. And let's be very clear on the projections that Sam has presented. We hit 2 degrees before 2050. So that's going to start being very interesting. And how we deal in that and act as we experience climate change more practically, as opposed to just thinking about it in advance. And the second shift that I really see is the adaptation finance is hitting the ground. I was in Rwanda a couple of weeks ago and working with their climate fund, and the transformation there is really quite interesting. You've moved from a situation where there's a couple of million dollars going here and there on a few projects to a systematic and capitalized fund, moving not just from tens of millions, potentially even to in excess of $100 million of programmed money going into climate adaptation and mitigation. And in that situation, the Ministry of Finance come to talk to the environment people because the money on the table looks interesting and there are really big opportunities there. I think the downside, and I think I do want to highlight this because it leads on to my point, is that while the money is flowing, we should be very honest about the fact that it's too low. We're not going to get anywhere close to the Copenhagen pledges in terms of $50 billion adaptation money. And even if we did, the latest adaptation gap report from UNEP shows that would be far too little. And there's going to be a lot of challenges actually in programming and financing that money, particularly when we move to areas and places where governance barriers are in place. So against that background, I think that's where Ruth and Harrow's and Mr. Kane's presentations and the information we're talking about comes in. And I see really two things which are very much aligned to my area. The first is about prioritisation. We're not going to have enough money, so what are we going to do with the money that we've got? How do we prioritise that? What makes cost-effective and economic sense, but also how do we get the benefits to flow to the most people, or even perhaps to the most vulnerable people? And those are potentially different. The second one is there are a number of challenges here that we have to address. I think we know most of these, the challenge of future climate change versus upfront costs. I think two that I think are really important are around leveraging for adaptation, which is going to be a lot more difficult with the private sector than it is for mitigation. And one which I think is almost this additionality challenge. I've been very lucky over the last year and travelled around the world for a certain development partner looking at how they're spending their climate finance. And I have to say, and I won't name them so I can be honest, it's a little bit disappointing. And you know, I'll give you an example. I pitched up in a certain Asian country and I said, what have you spent your money? They said, oh, this fantastic resilience program. I said, well, can you tell me exactly what it's doing? And they said, well, it's building earthquake resilient buildings. And I said, that's really good use of development money, but I don't really think it's an additionality with respect to climate finance. And what we're starting to see is people are plugging budget deficit holes with climate finance and just relabeling. And I think that's fine up to a point, but we're now in a bit where real climate change starts to happen, we've got to think about doing something different. And the final thing is, and this really goes back to something that Ruth said at the start, and I think SEI has been absolutely critical to this shift. Tom Downing as well, and others in the room, we've moved away from that old science-led thinking. You know, just ask the climate modeler and go down for a sequential linear chain. And whilst we've been saying it for over a decade, we're now starting to do it differently. And we're doing a number of things. We're focusing the problem around adaptation and thinking about problems rather than thinking just about science. As Sam has mentioned, we're mainstreaming, integrating, recognising that we're going to have to do this within the business of development and looking to scale up and leverage and do that within that framework. And finally, we're starting to think much more, I suppose, innovatively about using the tools and the knowledge that we have about what you do now versus what you do later. And iterative thinking, which goes back very much to something Sukaina mentioned about adaptation being a process. And I think SEI has been very instrumental in driving that forward. So I really leave you with a question before my lunch. And that's, if we're thinking, and we've got this reality of more money on the table, but we've got a real problem we have to address in these various challenges, how, or maybe even should, we prioritise the allocation of adaptation finance, and how do we balance economic efficiency with equity, whilst also showing additionality? And I wrote it down in case that.
Thank you very much, Paul. All right, last but not least, Benny Tamwana. Please introduce yourself.
Hi. I'm Benito Müller, and I'm here as convener international climate policy research at the ECI University. I'm also director of the European Capacity Building Initiative, in the context of which I have been working with particularly LDCs in climate finance, and amongst other things. I have advised them in the transitional committee, now on the Green Climate Fund board, and that's where my interest comes in. But first I have to admit something. I mean, you know, sometimes communities are defined in terms of a shared language or even a mutually intelligible idiom. And I feel I'm not of this community. There are things here which are here almost for the first time, which speaks against me, not against you guys, but knowledge broker, I have no idea what that is. Lunch, I hope. But it is important that we have some sort of cross-fertilization in this ball game. It's probably good for knowledge brokers not just to talk amongst each other. One of the questions which I would like to put forward, so not so much about climate knowledge leading to climate action, since I don't really know what climate knowledge is, I would like to talk about climate finance leading to climate action. Because I agree with Paul that we have a problem. I actually don't quite see it in the same dimension. My worry is, in the GCF in particular, we have half of the adaptation video is dedicated to the particularly vulnerable countries, LDC, six African countries, which means over the next 4 years or so, $2.5 billion. My big worry is that after 4 years, we will still have $2 billion in that pot, due to lack of projects. The famous, absorptive capacity not being there. And that would be a really bad signal for the donors and for everyone. So we need to ensure that good projects are forthcoming from the ground. And my question to you guys would be, how can you as knowledge brokers, or however you define yourselves, actually help, in particular the GCF, to achieve this aim, to be able to spend these $2.5 billion on adaptation in particularly vulnerable countries. Thank you.
Did you get that?
Yeah, you can shorten.
Okay, as Julia writes up the final question, the plan now is to get people at their tables to pick one of these questions that they're going to discuss for maybe about 10 minutes on the table. Then I'm going to come around and find out what people are talking about and sort of try and get a bit of an interaction between the tables and back again to the panel. I think it's going to be a problem of reading the questions. So I don't know, what shall I? Shall I just read them out again? Yeah. So Tahir's question was, how can knowledge brokering move from knowledge sharing towards more systemic actions? And is providing spaces for deliberation enough? So that those two connected. Then Blaine, if we're serious about achieving change, are we doing enough to track and measure success? And do we have the right tools for doing that? And then Paul, how should we prioritise allocation of finance? How do we balance the need for economic efficiency with equity and demonstrate additionality? And Benito, how can knowledge brokers help spend money designated for climate? And how do we ensure this results in climate action?
Yeah.
So if you're on the table with any couple of people, maybe you might think of joining another table. And try not to sit next to people you already know. And you've got about 10 minutes, and I'll start coming around after that. Okay. Now I'm going to start. Hello? I'm going to start interfering a bit in your conversations because I need to find out what people are saying. So, Jonathan, which question did you pick? Okay, and what are you been talking about?
We introduced ourselves well. We're really at the beginning of that discussion. I say that we haven't got very far with the question yet.
What have you actually, how did you start the conversation? And why did you pick that question?
We picked that question because we felt as a table that it covered quite a few different issues, and there were quite a few things wrapped up in it. None of us are climate finance people, so I think there was also quite an interest just to explore that question a little bit more and learn a bit more about it. And so really, I guess at the moment we're talking about sort of differences between prioritization at a subnational level and then prioritization at the global level, and that difference between equity and utility. I don't know if anyone else wants to.
Yeah, we were talking about the politicization of climate finance, and it was to do with the fact that we have this conditionality is not applicable to climate finance because developing countries see it as something which is for damages done to them. But then there's a kind of double standard in that, because on the one hand, we're not applying principles of, for example, equity and rights, but on the other hand, we are applying fiduciary standards and other kinds of standards. And one of the questions came up is whether or not the climate finance which is entering developing countries is not reinforcing existing power structures which are preventing us from increasing resilience.
Did anyone else talk about Paul's question? Any other tables to choose it? No? Paul, would you like to respond to what came up?
I might wait till they've got it a little further down the line.
Okay. Right, Tom, on this table, what did you pick?
I was taking a few notes here. So we picked the first question, Tahia's question, because we thought that it, if you mention systems, you know, that's like everything. and so it was a wide-ranging conversation, but I think I've got a sequence of things here, and then one provocative question back to the room. So first, the first question you have to ask is what system actually needs to change? Clarify what you're talking about. And then identify what is the decision point. The decision points are the action points, and that's where, if there's going to be any brokerage, that's where it needs to occur. But as you bring people together, people are capable of different levels of change, and what you've got to do is bring people along, people with different capacities, into a high capacity space at some point. And the message we want to give there is that co-development done properly costs money. So you've got to pick very carefully what it is you want to scale, and then decide to invest strongly in that. The implication there to me was that, there was discussion about you've got to start with the knowledge that's appropriate to the problem, and that's at a local level. So that's going to be generating the ideas of what you want to scale. That can't be top down. And then you identify what you want to scale, and you've got to realize that that's where there's going to be a lot of investment. The provocative question back to the room is, do brokers in practice become gatekeepers?
Thank you very much, Eric. Could someone at the table explain what moving from a low capacity space to a high capacity space?
Yeah, it's something that's tailored to different organisations, because each organisation will come to the table with different levels of capacity. And it's not that every organisation needs to be able to operate at the higher levels of capacity, because at the systemic level, that capacity can be held by other organisations. So to move into a higher capacity space isn't necessarily about every individual has to move up to that high capacity. It's about co-creating a systemic capacity that others can benefit right across the system.
And Diggy, what would be happening in that high capacity space that isn't happening in the low capacity space?
Yeah, okay. A lot of that would be about getting the right type of information in the right context and the right communications down to the people who need to use that information. If I can use the example maybe of smallholder farmers making a decision about what cropping practices they want to use, what seeds they want to buy, or so on. They're limited in their own capacity by maybe poverty or, you know, what's available, but the system itself is creating the seeds or the cultivation techniques. The government extension staff and private sector and NGOs extension staff are trying to get that out there to the farmers so that they can make better choices. Government regulations, legislation, funding and so on at the higher levels, creating that space, donors working across the whole thing. So at the systemic level, they are the ones who are developing and understanding the things that help that one decision being made by the farmer to be something that's more climate resilient, climate friendly or whatever. Yeah.
Would anyone else on this table like to add to that?
I think if I were to put a plaque on the wall, it would be following on from Harold Sukena's presentation, that co-learning is a disruptive framing of knowledge as innovation and learning in vastly different contexts, and really breaks down the duality of brokers and barriers and tries to get at the ontology and semantic learning that we're missing still.
Thank you, Tom. Did anyone else have a look at Tahir's question? Spaces for knowledge? Yeah. Would anyone like to speak?
Of course. We got to, in many ways, our conversation moved around spaces of hierarchy, silos, path dependency, the nature of these questions that begins by talking about a lower and a middle and an upper that separates people. And we were talking about the nature of relationships. And what is local? What is transference of knowledge? How does that come into application? Who is guiding that action? And it sort of moved it almost into a post-development space. Where is that sharing? Where is that catalyzing point? And many of those spaces may be when people are brought together from, you know, they might have their different hats for, I work for the UN, I work for an NGO, I'm a villager. I'm a farmer, take off those hats and come together with their various sorts of knowledge, build relationships, and from those relationships, that can be a jumping off point towards an application that shifts our idea of scaling. So you can have those relationships that might be connected across a global or a regional network, but the action is local, and the action comes from those immediate relationships. Where the people are seeing each other as human beings in a local space, rather than I'm at the top here with this money and you're here needing this money. Instead, everyone's bringing something to the table. And I think I totally went off on a tangent, so anyone else on the table?
I think another point we were discussing is about how knowledge flows and the directions it takes and whether that's the most effective way of doing things in the crisis situation that we're now. Because knowledge is driven from where the funds flow, obviously from the top to the bottom. But the need for the knowledge is very much at the local level, and that's where it's completely missing currently. So how do we change that? We've just about gotten around to that. And I think the other point that we were discussing is how do you drive change on the basis of knowledge that's generated at the local level? How do you then take it up to national and then global?
We also actually mirrored, I think, some of the things that Eric was talking about, which is that it's obviously very important to have a good grasp of what knowledge is co-created at a local level and facilitate that. But actually you also need to complement it by trying to understand what makes us do what we do. What is the action point? And there are various techniques that I think could be employed using studies from behavioral science as well that could be used to complement the simple sort of knowledge and information and actually then turn that into something that is applicable. And I just want to respond to Eric's interesting question about whether knowledge brokers are actually gatekeepers, which is a wonderful image. I have got an alternative image for you, which is trying to build on something that Sukena talked about being needs-informed or needs-driven. How about knowledge brokers are lock keepers?
Thank you very much for that, Rob. We've got some good images now for the board, gatekeepers and lockkeepers. Did anyone else try and answer Tahir's question? No? None of it. Tahir, have you got any responses to what you've been hearing?
Yeah, I can respond now or for the closing remarks.
If you've got a couple of things now, that's fine, or you can come back later.
If there is time later.
Okay, fine. Okay, so what question did you look at? Yeah.
We having established our carbon footprint before we got here, we then went on to look at sort of question two and question one, so to the monitoring. So I suppose if we focus on Blaine's question around the theory of change and how do we know when we get there, we didn't really come to any conclusions, but we... I talked about a practical action. We have an impact pathway that looks at how people can first access knowledge and then the steps that they go through in effect to then change the way that they behave and how you can capture that through case studies, but that's an incredibly difficult and expensive thing to do. And I think the conclusion that we came back to was the need to have at the outset the theory of change for how we think the change is going to happen. In order that we can then put the monitoring indicators into place. What else did we talk about? Oh yeah, we also talked about the role of gender in this and the fact that, you know, we do, again, looking at our own work, we do knowledge work in both Nepal and in Bangladesh. We do outreach face-to-face in Nepal, which is 90% with women because the men are often away in cities doing work. We've set up a call centre in Bangladesh. It's only been running for 6 months, but the first monitoring statistics we've had in, again aimed at smallholder farmers, are showing that 90% of the callers are men. And we are still looking at how is that information then getting translated for the women who are probably doing most of the work in reality. Is this about who controls the mobile phone? Is this about who controls the knowledge? And then how is the knowledge potentially filtered even between the call from the call centre and going back to the people who'll be able to act on it. So just an interesting example.
I mean, just to add, I think what's been really interesting at this table is starting from this very grounded approach. So we've all just kind of started from embedded in our context and our research programs, because that's kind of spoken out to two questions really, Tahir's as well. And where we've ended up is obviously making the obvious point that knowledge is political, but then in monitoring frameworks as well, how do we capture that? That knowledge itself is, you know, it's not a singular product and it's contested, and that contestation can be important. And obviously that's important to your theory of change. But I was talking about my research in informal urban communities, obviously where they are resisting kind of state-based risk assessments. And what do we make of that process?
Thank you. So did anyone else look at Blaine's question? Yeah. So who'd like to speak?
So I guess where we started from was not only that knowledge is contested, but also that what is success is, can be very much contested. And we tried to contrast that a little bit with ongoing discussions about indicators in the SDGs context, where we're basically starting to discuss on how these indicators that are being developed at the global level can be brought down to the national and the subnational level. And having people with experience in government, so some of the obvious first steps would be to break them down into national strategies and national actions. But then following up from that, it would be to allocate responsibility and to make clear who's responsible for what type of action and relate the indicators to that. But in the end, develop the indicators at the national and subnational level together with those who are actually responsible for taking the actions. Then a few stray remarks, which I can probably mention. We need to be clear whether we're measuring success or whether we're actually measuring failure. Another aspect we talked a little bit about, and especially again in the SDGs context, is going to be interesting to make sure that we're not only moving towards quantified indicators, but also make sure that somehow qualitative aspects are integrated in the indicator framework. And then finally, a point about communication, and again, this is where the experience from people within government comes in, is that it's probably going to be very difficult to communicate how success is being measured for 17 goals, and I don't know exactly how many targets underneath the goals, plus the indicators. So it might be useful for governments, when implementing the SDGs at the national level, to focus on a select few goals, a select few targets, and a select few indicators. If you want to add?
Could you just say what you meant by, are we measuring success or failure?
Well, it may be a very political point, but it's typical in if you are in those situations, it's so often happens that in reality you actually measure failure. And that's also, again and again, a repeated depression every time you have to present it, and it really doesn't really enhance. It doesn't really enhance action. So it's, you should never hide truth, of course. If we are really failing, it's important to not hiding that, but instead also, or at the same time, also finding ways of showing success. And that's important to define these ways where you also can show success, because otherwise you won't achieve it.
So there's still two tables I haven't spoken. Did you, which question did you do?
Well, thank you. First of all, it's very impressive to listen to everyone. I cannot imagine how you could discuss so much in 10 minutes. We must have done something wrong around this table. On the other hand, sometimes I know that those taking the microphone already have their agenda set, so they sort of report. But anyway, this is not happening here. It was a very bottom-up process. What we did, though, was discuss a number of interesting issues, and then we linked it to the questions afterwards. So, you know, it's a classical way of first answering whatever you want to answer, and then you link it to the questions. We started off actually with an interesting discussion a little bit about, you know, the business sector, because we had the expertise here, and I think it's a little bit going back to the question about knowledge, moving from knowledge to action, but also how do you measure actually success, for instance. And what we discussed was the fact that, you know, again, the sort of private sector is not at all very homogeneous. While many corporations today are very much up to climate action and take this issue seriously, the finance sector is, for instance, lagging behind quite a lot. And we realized that one of the knowledge brokers could probably be other corporations rather than scientists pushing the climate, you know, the finance sector to take action. I think that is a very important thing to remember. The scientists are not necessarily the best to push certain issues. We also, when we came to how do you then measure success, well, again, it depends very much on the actors. In terms of the financial sector, a success factor is return of investment. So they will find, you know, whatever they do, whatever action they take, if they get a good return on investment, that is a success for them. We may think that what has that to do with, you know, with climate change? Are you really doing something good here? Well, it doesn't matter. If we can combine, I think that is the mainstreaming issue that you talked about a lot also, if we can combine different incentives, then that is fine, you know, if we solve the problem. We also, I think, in the end had a very interesting discussion about, you know, do we really have relevant knowledge or not? We think we may have a lot of knowledge. Someone talked about the fact, before Anders, we talked about the fact that there's huge amounts of data, but how can we use the data? It's not lack of data. So do we have the right knowledge? And what you also said, Mr. Zia, was that, well, also, if we have knowledge and we turn it into action, have we tested that action? Or, you know, are we experimenting out there in the world? How do we know that the actions we are proposing really is the right action? Is it well tested? How do we know that we not make serious or huge mistakes? And I think that is an interesting point and quite, in a way, provocative, because we, as experts, we think we developed the best action. And then finally, on the finance issue, we didn't talk so much about it, but a little bit. I mean, you mentioned that in the finance sector, for instance, you have different tools, and you like the green bonds. So I think that, you know, if we take this a bit further and think about the climate fund, for instance, what can it do? It's such a small amount of money, looking at the overall flows of financial resources. So leveraging, for instance, is probably a key thing. How can you actually use the climate finance to leverage much bigger financial flows that are out there and are developing very quickly? I don't think I make justice at all to the group, but anyway, maybe if someone wants to add something.
Thank you, Jan. Okay, so this is the final table, I think. Which question did you look at?
Well, we looked at Paul's question mainly about the equity and vulnerability issues. So there was some discussion around whether we should be helping the most vulnerable people or the biggest number of people. And I don't think we actually took a vote in the end, but but I think there was some feeling that the most vulnerable don't have their own coping capacity to react to change, to move away or to react in other ways, and therefore perhaps that is where morally, you know, the money should be going. But then of course most government schemes that look at economic efficiency tend to look at it quite the other way, because they would look at perhaps number of lives saved and the financial value of that per dollar spent, which would actually probably send you in a different direction. So we didn't manage to solve that issue in the 10 minutes allocated, but I would like to just mention Matt's brilliant idea that perhaps the best thing we could possibly do would be to ban developed countries from investing at all in adaptation and say they could only invest in mitigation until the problem had been solved, and then they could perhaps spend some money on adaptation, and only developing countries should be allowed to spend money on adaptation. So I think that's quite a good solution.
That first point, I think it's an intractable question about how much, whether to spend on the most vulnerable or the most number of people. It's a bit like the question of how many people would you save to, how many people would you allow to lose their lives to save a species, and how many species would you allow to die to save a life. It's one of those questions you can't solve, but we have a political system that is the best we've got, I suppose, to solve those problems, so it's up to the political system to make those decisions. I'm not from this realm that you're in, but I have to reflect what Benita was saying, is that suffers a bit of TMA, too many acronyms. And when we're talking about knowledge broking, which I don't fully understand, but I am not getting the message from someone that's an outsider. You know, I've been doing modelling in climate change and looking at how to get more impact out of it, and I thought I would get more out of this in that regard, but I, a lot of it is going over my head, which I think is rather ironic, considering the subject matter.
Okay, thank you. Which hopefully that comment will... The next round, I just want to have one more round. We've got time for one more round of working in your groups. And it's thinking about what would it take to create change? So maybe that's part of it, like better language or better, you know, the communicators communicating more effectively. But so if you could have about 5 minutes again in your groups, building on the conversation and what you've heard from other people, what would it take to create change on this issue? Okay, time's moving on, so I'm just going to ask each... I'm going to ask each table to say one thing about how they would create change on this issue.
Yes, I'm afraid we are still talking a bit here at this table about the financial sector, and coming back to talking the language of the stakeholder you are about to engage. In this case, if you want to knowledge share or even knowledge broke, you need to speak the language of your counterpart. And in this case, the financial sector, it's very important to distinguish between the financial sectors as lenders, as bankers, which is all about risk. You need to define your impact is how to minimize or control the risk when you lend. While investors, completely other part or different part of the financial industry, it's much more about the return, and return can be defined as financial return and impact. And this impact, we need somehow in our community here to define this as a kind of performance management beyond the finance. And unless you can make that tangible, it's very difficult to activate that part of the financial community. However, they are very eager. There's such an enormous change going on right now. They're very eager. So I think we have an important role to try to define these measurements. And I think that's an important part of knowledge broker, because the word broker means you need to standardize somehow between two persons or two units. Otherwise, it's not brokerage, then it's just standard exchange. But if you want to make a brokerage, you need to find some standardization. And that's very important to do that from stakeholder to stakeholder.
Thank you. That sort of feeds a bit on what you were saying earlier about how you create that sort of communication and don't have obfuscating language like obfuscation.
Yeah, my brash Australian way of brought about a pretty interesting discussion that we had actually. Sukana gave us another explanation of some of the work that they were doing with the slides and with the different websites and bringing the information together and making it more available and understandable to people. And her explanation was just so much better than what I felt I experienced in that much more scientific approach of given the audience. But to me, it was there's a real disconnect with the scientific community. And if this is about knowledge brokering between the scientific community and people trying to understand how to get the most out of this, the knowledge, the climate change knowledge. Yeah. And I don't know how to solve it because we've all got careers in this world. But it is a real skill to be able to simplify it to me, and I think we need to work on that.
Okay, one message on how to create change.
Shall I go from my notes? Golly, one message? Okay, I'll shove them all together. So monitor steadily. Try scaling out many things. You're not sure which one's going to work. So you've got to monitor steadily. And you've got to be ready to cut the ones that aren't working. And that's the scary thing. And then we have lots of specific examples. They're great. They're wonderful.
Right. Okay. One message about how to create change.
Well, I can only give my message, and that is that policymaking needs to be an iterative process, so bottom up, top down, and feed into the system.
One message.
We discussed the financing again, and we thought that the quality of the democratic process in the countries themselves is very important in influencing how, in the end, an approach can be more pro-poor, more equitable. And we think that if the political system allows for decentralization of resources and decision-making so that local government gets more to say in terms of how adaptation and mitigation money is going to be spent, as well as civil society being able to advocate for the most vulnerable, I think a combination of the two is actually a very good approach. And then we gave the example of the Philippines where that is already happening, but in a lot of other developing countries, this is still a hope, a dream that may not or may come true.
Thank you. One message.
Building trust and listening well.
Thank you.
I think after some intensive discussion, we could say to make the threat visible on the very local level, and therefore hoping to generate a response from the local people to address climate-related risk. because it doesn't help much to speak about climate models, but instead of make it visible the threat and hope to say on this specific location this impact will happen, how we can address it. Anything more? Thank you.
Thank you.
I think our main message is education for all, because sometimes governments don't know even what is sustainability or what is climate services. So education for all.
Thank you, Monica. Okay, so we're now going to hear back from the panel. They're going to respond to what they've heard and their responses to their questions.
Good. Well, the good news for me is I don't have to report back to the Green Climate Fund, because clearly my question was not sufficiently well defined to get the sort of response which I hoped for. But let me maybe just twist it a bit, throw a question back to you for cogitation over the next few weeks. We now have a pilot phase on enhanced direct access that was decided, initially only 200 million, but it's going to go on. It's meant to be the signature access modality of the fund. In that pilot phase, what we are piloting are actually programs which use domestic financial transfer existing mechanisms of how to transfer money from the center to the local level. Preferably then used through local intermediation. In other words, the decisions about which projects, individual projects, are to be funded are meant to be taken at the local level, be that local authorities, in the case of SMEs, their banks, that they can actually give credit lines to the SMEs. The SMEs are not going to the capital with their little projects, okay? So these sort of architectures are being tested, but in that context, there's a huge need for these local actors to actually be able to generate projects. And to tools which are somewhat standardized, because you have to be able to replicate them and produce them knowledge at scale, if there is such a thing. Okay? So what I would like you to do is, in essence, think about this, of how can you help the GCF in this context to provide tools for the local level to generate the project proposals which will make this a success. Thank you.
So from work experience, I've seen how bottom-up processes are really important for legitimacy and relevance. But I think if we have to be realistic and to achieve what you guys have called a high systemic capacity space. We have to also think how to link these bottom-up processes with top-down processes, and it's important because otherwise we are hitting power dynamics, we're hitting structures that are different, difficult to change. And we were discussing here in the panel about very concrete examples of how some projects at the end get, instead of being very inclusive, because there are really good ideas at the local level, they end up being decided and managed by very few people that are more, you know, let's say at a higher level of decision making. So how do we really make these bridges is important to have a systemic capacity in place. And for that, I think knowledge brokering can play a key role because we have tools, we're working on tools, we're improving ways of communication, we're improving how to manage different languages, like he was discussing this table as well. So I think that's that nexus between the bottom-up processes and the top-down processes is key, because the decisions are taken at that level. Maybe the actions then will be decentralized, as the example there in the table was given.
Thank you. So I suppose just the comment is that I still think there's a need for some type of action planning and prioritization, because if you don't do that explicitly, you do it implicitly by default. And I think there is a challenge between trying to get the return on investment and the leveraging, which will attract certain types of investment, versus trying to target those who are perhaps most vulnerable, which are large numbers of diffuse actors with little opportunity for profit generation. So I think there's a challenge there. But I think in terms of creating change and in terms of knowledge brokering, the one thing that comes through very strongly from today is a need to move downstream and get practical. more than anything else, and you know, I don't want to be critical of the discussion we've heard today, but I think there quite often is a need to focus and be practical to achieve Benito's objectives of trying to get these things programmed on the ground that really require us to do what's good enough as opposed to what's the sort of perfect.
Sounds like we'll all be singing from the same hymn sheet up here. So a couple of take-homes that I've got here, and the first one I think comes around. It comes back to capacity and the need to build systemic capacity. It's all well and good to have the best science in the world. It's all well and good to have the best sort of widgets for digesting and combining information. If that's not making it down to the ground into ways that actually lead to smart projects, projects that are actionable, projects that are fundable, we've fallen short. The other one that I take back is the challenge to try lots of things, and that links, I think, quite closely to the question of monitoring and monitoring well, which is that the question of why are we measuring at all? Why are we doing this measuring? We're measuring to learn. And to learn and to fail faster and to fail better, so that when we're failing, we're actually failing up towards a better next iteration of what we're trying to do. We're experimenting because we're entering into a problem space that is poorly defined, that has loads of uncertainty. In fact, in order to take advantage of that, we need to experiment, we need to be willing to fail, but we need to document our success. We need to document it effectively so that we can pass on those lessons to others who are going to be facing the same challenges.
Right, thank you very much. I guess it's the nature of a wide-ranging conversation like this that there's a lot of more questions coming up and no solutions particularly, but I hope you found the interaction useful and interesting, and I'd just like to say thanks very much to our panel for their contributions. Okay. So now I'm going to pass over to Johan Schoenenschina to sum up.
Okay, I'm going to sum up. I think we are all in a mode of high systemic capacity space. I really love when I get some kind of new expression that, you know, I can impress people with. You know, you walk around and you see this face on those that you're talking to, either, what a weird guy, or sometimes, wow, I'm impressed. Sounds really difficult that. He must come from a science-based organization. Anyway, I'm not going to summarize. I think it's been extraordinary, interesting, and nice discussions here today, and also really well moderated. So we had a chance to really have this interaction. It's very difficult quite often when you have a large audience, and I think that has been really great. A couple of things that I take with me before I would ask Andreas. Where did Andreas go? Oh, there. To also join me. You know, it's very clear what Paul also said in the end here. We need to really start to look at what is, you know, what needs to happen on the ground. You know, actions, having much more a solution-oriented agenda. One thing, though, in that discussion that I think we still struggle with, and I can also hear that here, is that there are short-term goals, but there are also long-term challenges. And how we deal with these both short-term goals, the fact that actually we still, if you look at the SDGs, we are still having 2 billion people living in poverty. We still have huge development challenges in the world. And at the same time, we have long-term systemic changes in terms of climate change and so on. That priority setting for policymakers, and I'm going to throw this back later to Andreas, you know, when you're a politician, what do you focus on in then? And how can we, as researchers, try to really address that challenge, short-term, clear problems people are facing with the long-term perspectives, so we don't lose track of that. The mainstreaming came up very well, I think, and Sam, I mean, you brought it up in your presentation, and mainstreaming is fine, I think, and it's absolutely important, but it's also, there is a bit of a challenge sometimes also when we start to mainstream, and when we start to link to all other areas of politics and so on, is that it can also become very complex. And you may sometimes lose track of what, you know, your key perspective is. And I think that is, you know, we love complexity, of course. In SEI, we love complexity. It's our bread and butter. as for all researchers, you know, when you can really, this is a very complex issue within a high systemic capacity space that we have to address. You know, it's really there. But in reality, we have to embrace complexity, but we have to be able to somehow also demonstrate, and this came back also with you, Sam, and also many of the other speakers, we have to demonstrate the co-benefits within a complex system. I think that is one way out of that complexity, saying that yes, that we are actually addressing also with the solutions, that we are looking at, many different perspectives that we need to address in society. One also thing that I really believe we have to be honest and bring up now with the SDGs, we were dishonest and not daring to focus on it with the MDGs, is that there are goal conflicts also. You know, at least in short term, but also partly long term. In the MDGs, they became very obvious because you had six sort of development-oriented MDGs, and then in the end you added, by the way, we should also maybe save environment somehow over there. With the SDGs, this becomes much more obvious and much more important, because the SDGs finally is not just focusing on poverty, they also focus on real development. Nobody wants to stop at going from $2 to $3. Ah, I'm happy. No, that's not the way we function. It's really about development. And the goal conflicts will come there. And that's going to be difficult. It's going to be very difficult for us. Is climate more important than water issues? Is it more important than ecosystems? Of course, we always say, no. They are all connected. But there will be goal conflicts, both short-term and long-term. And the question is how we can manage that. And I think it comes back to addressing multiple systems at the same time as well. And the final thing I would like to bring up also, and I think comes out of this discussion, and now I really will, you know, start to push over to Andreas here, is how do we, when we talk about mainstreaming, how do we really mainstream into the decision-making processes that are really making a difference? I mean, I can take Sweden, and Sweden is quite often highlighted as a very progressive country when it comes to environmental issues and so on, but when we talk about our national annual state budget, very little on environment. I mean, where the really key decision-making structures are, Ministry of Finance, sorry Andreas, Ministry of Finance, those dealing with trade negotiations, industrial development, infrastructure investments, that's where decisions are made. And we are sometimes over here, I think, and we think we are maybe at the center of attention, but it's completely different settings and different arenas and so on. And I think we still have some challenges of getting in there. So Andreas, why don't you join me after this little sort of expose in high systemic capacity space. It takes me some time to pick this up. I like more simple things. I really love still that American baseball player who said, you know, when was asked, what do you think about next season? Well, you know, the future is not what it used to be. That makes sense. That sort of connects to you. But Andreas, you have been a minister for many years. You were also very active at the negotiations in Copenhagen. We can come back to that a little bit. But as a minister, you engaged a lot with scientists. I know that because you engaged a lot with SCI, among others, but also many other organizations. When do you think a scientist is, what do they need to do in order to be successful to communicate with a politician like yourself? Even though you were convinced about climate change, but what are the key success factors for us to make you, yeah, I know, I understand, I can take this forward?
Well, I think one important thing is that I don't need complex knowledge because I'm already in such a complex environment. It's important, I think, to think about it, because if you become a minister, you are immediately in a very complex situation where you have on one hand your government, your cabinet, and you have the opposition, of course, you have international negotiations, you have EU, you have public opinion. It's enormous, many different actors to take into account. And of course, you will always claim that opposition is your main enemy. But the main enemy is actually all the other ministers in government, and there is especially one. And you mentioned it, it's the finance minister. So what I need is actually also knowledge that I could use in that constant negotiating process where I am in. Because being a minister means you're always in constant negotiations. In government, of course, but also with other countries' ministers and internationally. And in the end also in a sense, but in another sense with the public opinion.
SCI has been very much involved in international research initiative, research policy initiative called New Climate Economy, which was initiated actually during the former government. And with many collaborators also here in the UK and elsewhere. In that, we try to sort of, you know, we argue that with financial terms that, you know, this transition to low carbon society and so on is not that expensive. It's just a couple of billion dollars, you know, and so on. Trillion even, yes, trillion dollars. But if you look at it, you know, in totality, it's only a couple of percent. Is that the kind of information that you need, and at what level? Because we are still talking about global level up to 2035. Can that really be translated to daily politics?
Well, it is still very important, I think, because you always need a kind of knowledge to convince both public opinion and other countries' ministers and governments as well. But you also need knowledge that could really be competitive with the experts at the finance ministry. If you're back home again, after those great international negotiations, you know that environment ministry are very good, but they usually, in all governments, they collect the most famous economists in government, in finance ministry. So you need actually also a lot of knowledge that could compete and be competitive and show that this is a case where we can go. I mean, also, I had many cases where I was negotiating on measures where, of course, I was asked, can you prove, in one sense or another, that this will really lead to something? And we don't give you money for something where you will anyhow just be criticized. It's much better to give you money for something where you can show a success and where you, in the end, also can create political success, which is always, in the end, an important currency. Sam?
I have two more sort of short and very simple questions. You were part of the Copenhagen negotiations. Sweden was then the EU presidency. Thank you very much. So we had a very strong role there, disproportionately compared to our population. Which meant that you also had a very strong role there. I mean, from my perspective, looking at the rear mirror, I think Copenhagen was actually very successful, to be honest. I think it was successful because it really, you know, demonstrated that the system we had for negotiations didn't work any longer. The world looked completely different. We didn't have North-South. I mean, there were many things that really needed a shake, I think. So I think this sort of political community, they are understanding this now, and they are trying to find their ways forward in a new set of thinking, maybe in Paris. Would you argue that the scientific community or the expert community, whatever we want to call us, who are sort of also part of this, have we also understood this shift in political realities and sort of understood that we have to maybe work in a different way with policymakers in order to shape Paris in a way to be a positive conference in the end?
Well, I think actually yes, because mainly what was happening, and to me in those days, I didn't at all experience this as a success, and I never tried to claim it was a success. I said it was a catastrophe, and that was also very bad communication. I experienced that when I met the Danish presidency later on, but still. I think it shaped the whole system, both scientists, politicians, and the whole system as such, which was important. There were many lessons to learn. One was actually, and I think we've really, and with Sam's example this morning again, showed us that we have moved coming together between developed and developing countries. But you must understand that also a small country like Sweden, we came with huge delegations and a lot of expertise behind. As I met an African minister, for example, had of course much, much less. And it made usually also African ministers avoiding negotiating with European ministers or other developed countries' ministers because they knew they would be absolutely subordinated also regarding knowledge, and if I pay for the knowledge that the African country should have, should he or she really certainly trust that or not? In Sweden's case, maybe, but it's important also to create that kind of trust for the knowledge that is produced by the scientists, and I think that's another aspect that should be added here. The capacity building is extremely important, will always be also, to a big extent, paid by developed countries, must be useful for the developing countries. And to bridge this is one of the most important aspects, and also to keep the vision. I think we will get an agreement in Paris. It will be very differently framed from what we experienced in Copenhagen, but I still think it won't match the needs. So we must really find these ways of continuing upgrading the scale of ambition step by step afterwards.
Thanks. Maybe we can agree that then Copenhagen was a catastrophic success. So if that is okay in English to say that, I think. Yeah. But it's very interesting what you're saying about trust also, in a way, who has funded the research, who has funded the data and so on. I think, I mean, many of our colleagues here today, when they have stated how important it is to involve stakeholders from the beginning, really from the beginning, that is one way of building that trust. And finally then, I mean, talking about the future, and one of my other favorite quotes that many of my colleagues know from Niels Bohr, that predictions are difficult, especially about the future. One thing that, he was a Dane, that's why, very clever, in your case, you were a minister. I mean, you, even though you were a minister for environment, you still had some power. Being a politician, now you left politics and you are actually back to academia. You are with the Newman Institute and really back to science. What do you take with you from politics back into science that you think, what can you contribute with your experience into the scientific process of the Newman Institute? And are there some frustrations about leaving the power of politics and going back to, the scientific realities where we always fight, but we never really get anyone to listen to us?
But I think, first of all, it's a relief. Now I'm in the position where I can claim I have some knowledge to say that politicians don't do enough at all. So that's a very nice position. Basically, I'm educating young people, and I think that is maybe the most inspiring part as well, because as a minister you're always the sort of part of a short-lived species. I mean, ministers, they come and go, and in the end you're just one short little part of a long, long chain, and after, again, you will come others, and to educate, and hopefully also in transformational education, educate young people to make sure there's a stronger links coming after you in the chain. That's a great inspiration. But of course, for me, it's also frustrating because I'm always being a doer. So that's sometimes less. But I'm happier now than I was as a politician, I would say, because it's much more inspiring to work with young people.
Thank you. So that takes our chat to an end. I would like to ask Ruth to come back and also sort of close the seminar. But before Ruth, I know you are going to do a lot of thanking and so on, but I also would like to, on behalf of SEI sort of globally, not least thank the Oxford Centre for organizing this. I know there has been a lot of hard work behind it. It's a small centre with an extremely dedicated staff, working hard hours just to do their research, and then suddenly we come dropping in from above and say, please organize a seminar and organize this and that and so forth. And you've done so in an extraordinary good way. It's been excellent to have this broad audience here. Sam, I must say, I also appreciate very much that you have taken the time to come and participate in the seminar and really contributing very much to the discussions. And the collaborations we had with CDKN has been extraordinarily interesting and good. And I think it demonstrates how important this also from the perspective of funding, for instance, to have new mechanisms that can actually, get out of maybe old thinking how things should be funded. In research, sometimes very strict to certain areas, how we can actually work much more interconnected. is really, really key here, and bridge, not least, between science, policy, and practitioners. So I think that's been important. But Ruth, over to you.
Thank you, Ewan and Andreas, for giving us the sort of the high-level picture and putting it all into context, all our thoughts. Yes, a few thank yous, really, from me. Several people have said to me, this has felt a little bit like a reunion, lots of people meeting with our friends. and, you know, we want to thank, they're thanking us, but also we want to thank the board, of course, and management and SEI for giving us the opportunity for, it's an honour for the board to come and have their, hold their board meeting here, and it gives us this great opportunity to convene this seminar. Maybe a little bit, you know, the first rule of communication is to know your audience, and maybe we didn't really realise, but underneath maybe we slightly had two audiences. We wanted to impress the community, the climate community, but we wanted to show everyone what our body of work, really, I suppose, over many years here in Oxford. We also wanted to impress the board, of course. So maybe there's a bit of a tension between, yeah, some of the language that's been used. So, thank you for this opportunity. They've given us, SEI have given us support in many ways. Yona came over on Friday. She's been central to organising the board events and helping us along with the practicalities. The comms team led by Rob has given us a lot of support, preparing us for our presentations and so on, giving us ideas, talking through how the whole morning would work. And then coming back to Oxford, thank you for all, particularly within SEI Oxford, to Grace Gordon for logistics, finding the venues. She did an incredible job, and she's, you know, nothing has gone wrong because of her fantastic planning. Annalie, very much on the communications, bringing the web team, the photographer, the scriber together. And Maria Frindle, again, for helping with the management. Is she here? And helping out today as well. Ongoing support for SEI Oxford. And then finally, thank you to our panelists, Tahir, Benito, Paul, and Blaine. To our keynote speaker, Sam, thank you so much. And to Sakena and Harrow. Anyone else? Kate, sorry. Thank you so much for Kate, who for moderating. Fantastic. This all had to come together quite quickly towards the end. And also thank you to St. Hugh's for this beautiful venue. I mean, it's worked out so well for us. That's been great. For the sake of trust, there's been a lot of talk about that and transparency. Paul let the lunch cat out of the bag. So just for everyone to say, we're basically hosting a lunch for our board members and our panelists and so on. So I do apologise for those of you that's come along and not getting any lunch. I'm sure you have a lot of work to get back to. But I just wanted to explain that. If we could, we would have loved to have you all for lunch, but it's been a little bit of an expensive few days. Johan knows that. Okay, thank you everyone. And to the board as well. Thank you. And lunch is at 1. Thanks, Paul.